everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com. Yes, we're still here. We haven't flooded away or blown away. We have been very busy though, doing some presentations, and sometimes the weather has not been cooperating, but we have nothing to complain about compared to so many people that are suffering. So we'll take what we have and be very grateful and send our prayers to those who have been flooded and hurricaned and
tornadoes,
and I mean, it's just
fires,
tremendous.
Forest fires, it's amazing.
Yes. This is a September garden tour. It's been a while, but like I said, we've been busy. Something that some of our viewers have been talking about is what happens at the end of summer. Seed collecting, cutting things back. So we're going to show you a couple of things that we are noticing in our garden, and then what you may have in your garden that relates to that. One of the things I wanted to show you is sedum. Many, many people have sedum. This is autumn joy. And this is what happens to autumn joy, at least the older version. It rains, the blossoms get too heavy, and it flops over. Well, if you have time about mid-June, when the plants are still in a smaller form, you can trim them in half, almost in half. And what happens then is they blossom a little later. The heads are not as large. They're smaller heads, but look, it's standing up. It's not flopping. So I did this on purpose so that I can show myself that I need to make time about mid-June to do this with all of my sedum, because this looks much better than that. We're on the outside of our yard now, as you would see it from the street. And while there is still a lot of green going on, most of the flowery part has gone for the time being, for this year. Again, the sedum is still going. That adds nice color. And you can see that some of our Chinese lanterns have survived, even though they were kind of
trampled
or taken over by this chameleon plant.
Oh yeah, we have to definitely eliminate this thing.
Yes, as beautiful as it is, I mean, and it gives you a lot of color and variation, but as you can see, it just takes over.
It's invasive.
And it is invasive, yes. The peaches are done. There'll be a lot of trimming that we need to do on them, and this year we need to put down our protective copper antifungal spray in the fall and then again in the spring. This is how giant fleece plant looks if you leave it alone and you don't trim it back. It's not awful unless you like a really neat garden. Then you'd probably want to cut that back. But we kind of like it for the winter because it adds a vertical interest in the garden rather than just everything flat and full of snow. There are some flowers that are just coming into their beauty right now, and some of those would be in the chrysanthemum family. Chrysanthemums come in a variety of colors, sizes, shapes, doubles and singles, and they're absolutely beautiful to add color this time of year. You go to the garden centers and there will be these huge ones with immaculate heads, just absolutely gorgeous. Be careful if you want them as far as planting them in your garden as a perennial. Last year we bought what we thought were perennial geraniums.
Well, they were listed as perennials.
We made sure it said hardy chrysanthemums, and we thought, well, this is good. This is right. This is the only one that lasted, and we probably planted a dozen,
A dozen. I think we planted 22, if I remember correctly, and
yes,
only one survived. They were not hardy.
They said right on there, hardy. Well, they must have meant annually hardy, because they were not perennial hardy. So if you are going to get chrysanthemums this time of year to plant, to come back each year, ask them, are these perennials or are these annuals? Because you want perennials, unless you're just putting them on your front porch and you just want a beautiful color, which is absolutely gorgeous. Another thing is, if you have flowers that are in your garden now and you like them, Rick really likes this tickweed, you don't have to go to any big problem of reseeding. You just bend them over and let them go back in the garden. They will reseed themselves and no work to it. Same would be for this rose mallow. These are all old rose mallow flowers. Just bend them over. If you don't bend them over, they will obviously just plant themselves wherever they want. But if you want to keep them in an area, you can just bend them over and kind of control where they go.
Now, some seeds need to go through a stratification period, meaning a cold spell.
That's right. And these will do that by themselves because they're going to sit there all winter. And that's what they need to regrow themselves for next year. These are actually annuals, but because they seed themselves, they'll come back next year. Another reseeding annual is cosmos. You see them everywhere. They're those dainty, feathery ones. Because they're so tall, they kind of will seed themselves wherever they want because they'll flop in the wind and then they get blown all over. But they're lovely and you can pull them out if you don't like where they fall for next spring. Cannas. We got ours in very late because we were busy.
Well, we were redoing this entire area as well, so that's...
And we hoped that they would bloom, and we are pleasantly surprised to see that at least this one has, and I think the other ones will. But even if they don't, because of these beautiful maroon leaves, they add a beauty of all their own.
Nice textural difference.
Yes. Zinnias. Now, I have never had a zinnia come up by itself after a winter, so... Maybe it's just because we have mulched too much, but I like them the way they are. If they come back, they'd be lovely. But right now, this is a haven for not only the hummingbirds who are filling up for their great journey back to their winter lands, but also for bees.
Well, the butterflies sure enjoy them.
Yes, and the butterflies. The variety of color, the different sizes and the fact that, you know, you have some that are done and some that are just starting, and hopefully these will last until the first frost and everybody will drink their fill.
I say you have a lot of zinnias this year.
Yes. And they're so neat because they're so different. Now, just look at that. These have the little crowns, the little halos that show up. And this one just looks like a mushroom almost. Very pretty. There's a pink one over there.
Yep.
Very lovely. One of the plants that we moved because we needed the space for something else, but also it wasn't doing real well, was the Chinese lilacs that Rick got on an infomercial. And since we moved them here, they have more light, they have more room, and they are definitely doing better than they did in their old house or in the old location. So sometimes it's just a matter of moving what you have that's not doing well to another space and giving them a new life, new chance. Another example of moving a plant to a different location and having it do well are these giant hardy hibiscus. They were around the corner here, and while they got plenty of sun, we just thought they'd do better here, and we wanted something beautiful to be along the edge of this gazebo. For the first year, I mean, they were moved in the spring, and they went ahead and blossomed anyway. We were hoping to get some seed pods off of these, especially the pink ones, but for some reason, maybe it's because they're young, there don't seem to be a lot of seed pods that are showing up. So we'll just have to wait and see how they do next spring.
Boy, these mosquitoes are something else. My goodness.
We had pretty much no mosquitoes for most of the summer. It was wonderful.
Well, then we had 3 weeks of rain.
And then we had rain and more rain, and then it got warm again. And I mean, it's perfect for mosquitoes. I went out this morning. I had a sweatshirt on and only this part of my hand was showing, and I got bit right on the knuckles. This is the first year I ever had mosquito bites on my ears and on my neck. So you have to spray yourself. Unfortunately, you have to use DEET because that seems to be the only thing that works. We have had several cases of the Nile virus that comes from mosquitoes. I can't think of the proper name of it right now, but in Waukesha County. So you don't want to be bit, and they're attacking Rick while we're talking. This plant right here reminds me of somebody taking a yellow highlighter and just streaking it across a green plant. This is a goldenrod, and this is supposed to be a good goldenrod, not the kind of wild goldenrod. The bees absolutely love it. It gives them, again, it gives them something to collect their nectar and their pollen. And it's very nice. I do take the precaution of one that starts to go to seed, I do cut off all the seed heads and just let it come up from the roots. If you have potted plants, these are also adding color to your yard. This is a kale.
Decorative kale.
Cabbage, yeah. We have not chewed on it, but it looks very pretty. This is a dahlia we planted in a pot. We made sure it wasn't one of the huge, tall ones. It's a shorter, compact version. Again, beautiful. Zinnias, petunias, sweet alyssum, marigolds. All beautiful choices for the fall. We've had a couple of people talk about liatris and how do I know when it's ready to collect the seeds. If you look at this, you see that the blossoms are long ago gone, but these are not ready. You don't see a defined dryness. But if you move along, this one's getting ready. This is drier. I'm trying to see if I can find one that is ready.
I would say because of all the rain we've had, although it has been dry for a couple of days.
Well, it's been dry and then it's been foggy. So you may not have the actual wetness falling out of the sky, but it is all around. I think I got some off of this one the other day. Let me see.
Yeah, now, that one's not quite ready.
This is not ready because you should be able to just take your hand, kind of gentle pressure, and it should come off. Now, some of them did, but that's nothing like what it will be. Nope. Now, I have taken a couple off of this one already. All I did, because I didn't think it was ready enough, I chopped off the actual stem and I put it in an open paper bag. Note to seed collector, mark your bags before you go out. Take a magic mark or whatever, mark on it what color it is, what it is, and you'll be much happier when the seeds.
How about the seed pods from your giant hardy hibiscus?
The white hibiscus always sends beautiful seeds. These, they're not ready yet, but they're getting ready. And in there will be a bunch of seeds to plant. This is how I've propagated some of them. I was hoping the dark red one over here, the Midnight Marvel, would give me some seeds, but you can see none of them were...
They just drop off, blossoms drop off when they're done.
Either they weren't pollinated, which I find hard to believe.
How about that one way at
this
the top
one right there?
Yeah.
Maybe.
How about that one?
But what we found is... Oh, this one maybe. I don't know. The ones that we have found, no, you just feel it. There's a couple of seeds in there.
Yep.
But again, I don't think this would be a viable one. Either that, or maybe they were bred not to
seed themselves.
Produce seeds. Yeah, they might be sterile. Who knows? There is one of them over there, though. It's a pink one that seems to be having some heads, so I'll be collecting those seeds in a bit. Well, our strawberries didn't give us a whole lot of strawberries this year. We are going to give them another chance. And at this time of year, what you want to do is make sure that you have as many of the weeds out of there as possible. I went through here, was that last week, Rick? And I swear I got a whole wheelbarrow full of weeds out of here. But I also was able to take these little baby ones.
The escapees?
Except for these ones that I missed. And if they're still attached to the mom and they don't have any roots on them yet, I just make sure that they get back in the bed. And I will probably put a little mound of dirt on the stem part so that this part actually comes in contact with the ground, because as you can see, it's putting out roots. So if it comes in contact with the soil, it'll have a chance to set root. So I put a little piece of soil right there to make sure the contact stays.
So you have to tuck them in.
I do. And then once it freezes and everything's on the top is done for the summer, then we'll put straw on top of them to protect them from the freezing and the thawing. Look what I found.
Yeah, no wonder they never make it into the house.
They're at their end of their life.
You look like a chipmunk.
I am a chipmunk. Many of the ones you see are beyond eating right now. They have gone past their due date. There's still some good ones, and we've had so many this year that we just can't give them away fast enough. But that's okay. That's what we love, and we like sharing.
Well, they're still growing too.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you know, you still have a lot that haven't even started.
That's right.
So hopefully we'll have enough warmth.
Right, depending on, especially with cherry tomatoes like this, they'll go on a long time.
Well, these are the indeterminate.
Right. The other ones, the ones with the larger tomatoes, a lot of them are almost to the end now. But as long as they're giving me tomatoes, I will leave them up. As soon as they're done, I will be taking them out. I usually do not put them in my compost bin, only because I don't want any chance of fungus or disease or anything that might be on them, like hornworm eggs or something. So I will put those in the trailer. We'll take them to the recycling center.
And let somebody else have to deal with
that. That's right. Our dear friend Lark from Lark's Perennials gave us seeds for this beefsteak plant. And all summer, it was a dark burgundy. It was absolutely beautiful. A little bit of that color is still there. Then it went to seed. And you can see this is going to seed itself everywhere. Now I have a batch of them here, and I had them a batch of them in the back. The batch I had in the back last year, which was just a couple of plants, put seeds out, and of course then the parent plant dies. Well, the seeds that little batch over there put out planted itself in the cracks of the sidewalk, in between the board and the sidewalk. That's where I got all of these plants from. So I am just terrified that if I leave all these seeds on, that's the only plant that we will have left in our garden. So what I've done in the back is I've trimmed it. Every branch that had seeds on it, I trimmed it down to here. And I figure if they come up from the roots, fine, but I'm not gonna have all these seeds.
Well, are these annuals or perennials?
I think they're, I'll seed myself perennials.
Okay.
I'll seed myself annuals and become a perennial.
Maybe they're wannabes.
I think they are. They are pretty, though. I mean, even the seed pods are pretty, yep. And the burgundy is great.
Well, maybe we just have to capture some of these seeds just for the fun of it.
I'm sure I will miss some, and I'm sure they will show up again next spring. This spring, I put these caladiums in the ground, and I have been ever so pleased with how they have come up. They are just amazing, and I have batches of them many places. They like more of a shady area. This one over here, let me just show this one. This one gets more sun than those other ones, and you can see this one is a smaller version of these over here that are in the shade. Just very pretty, and again, they come in all different colors and varieties. Another beautiful flowering and beautiful, just the leaves are so beautiful, is the coleus. And that can go not only in the shade but also in the sun. I like to take the blossoms off of it because I don't want the energy going into those. You can take cuttings of coleus, stick them, just cut them off. Stick them in some water and see if you can get them to root. If you can get them to root, then you can try to keep them for the entire winter and plant them again. I love my art.
Yeah, put a red paintbrush in your hand and you disappear for an entire day, and I come out and the house is painted red, the sidewalk's painted red.
The house is not red.
The trees are painted red, the bushes are painted red.
I saw a picture of this very same archway before I painted it. We were about ready to throw it away. It looked so awful. And now look at it. It became the base of our red accents. And look at who else is enjoying it.
Oh, little squirrels, huh?
Yeah.
Have a little resting eating place here.
Uh-huh. Let me put that there for a snack kind of place.
Oh, then they don't have to bury it.
As long as the weather hangs in there, we will still get some more petunias that'll open up.
They're just about at their end, though.
But they're at their end, yeah. Again, there's some of the goldenrod that I was talking about. And black-eyed Susans, another dahlia over there, some geraniums, and another hardy hibiscus. And then there's a hibiscus over there in the corner.
The seed pods.
It does have some seed pods,
and
it is a pinky one, right. So we'll see. A lot of the old blossoms are empty, though, so we'll have to watch that and see if they come up.
Okay.
This is going to be an aster. I believe this is a New England aster. Last year it didn't show up. I was hoping we hadn't lost it, and I don't think we have. But you also see we have.
Ooh,
thistles.
A beautiful thistle.
Mm-hmm.
Wow, how did you miss this one?
And we have some, what they call that, eggs and ham, eggs and butter. Butter and eggs, that's what this is. This is a wild snapdragon.
Invasive.
Very invasive. The people that we go to the prairie with pick it out whenever they see it. It's just very naughty. Pretty, but naughty.
Kind of like you.
Thank you. We've enjoyed our waterfall. It's lovely.
Well, how about our little visitors, too?
We've had more frogs this year than we ever have in the past.
Oh my goodness, that one was humongous. You know, that would barely fit in.
Yeah, there he is. He's right there.
Oh yeah, there's his head sticking out. Oh, he would make a good supper.
No.
Oh.
Of course not. He's catching mosquitoes. You don't want him eating.
No, we'll keep him and his four little siblings.
Yes. The fish are getting large.
Yeah, those were feeder goldfish that we put in spring.
They were maybe this big.
Now they're at least 6 inches or more.
Eating mosquito larvae.
I'm happy to see, even though we really chopped away at our water, lilies, mm-hmm. that they're starting to come back and fill in nicely. That's encouraging. And of course,
my picnic deck. We haven't actually been out here to picnic on this deck because either it's been too very hot, or again, it's been raining.
Or mosquitoes.
Oh, now it's mosquitoes.
And stink bugs.
Don't even talk about those things. They're awful. Look at our climbing
spinach.
Spinach has taken off. It took long for this to get going, but now it's going great. Tastes wonderful. I should put some on our sandwiches today.
We should. And for everybody who's been wondering, when the heck are they going to start siding our house? My goodness, we've been back and forth. Three different times we've had to switch this thing because either one product wasn't available or that color wasn't available. So now they keep telling us, well, maybe what, October 3rd? 8th?
October 8th.
I'll believe that when I see it.
I know.
What year?
We started this whole process in May, and it's now mid-September, going toward the end of September. But, you know, hopefully it'll get done, and we'll be very happy with it. The plants we got to actually put into our Liberty Garden have done quite well, especially the asparagus. Just look at this. This is taking off. It is wonderful. We know now, though, that once it freezes, we need to chop it down to the ground and take the old things and put them in the compost bin. There's a beetle, I guess, that likes to harbor itself in there, and we don't want that to be bothering it next spring when maybe we'll finally get one to eat, or maybe a whole bunch of asparagus.
I see you ripped out all the beans already.
No, not the beans. I ripped out the
cucumbers.
Right. Look at my zinnias, how lovely they are. The beans are still going. Look at, you can see all the blossoms. And they've been doing very well. My cucumbers came up really nicely. They had lots of blossoms on them. There were tiny little cucumbers on them. And then when we got all that rain, they just
the roots got
withered down.
Rotted.
I don't know what it was. So they're gone for now. I'll try again next summer and hopefully get them in the ground sooner so that we can actually enjoy some. Our north garden has done very well this year. Remember, we had garlic that started in the early spring. We had our extra tomato plants that didn't fit up in the other garden. We had this one tomato berry, but the golden variety.
Another reason they don't make it to the house.
Yep, these are very good. I'll share with you.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. I mean, I actually get one.
Sure. Our peppers did fantastically. You can see the stink bug off
still
of there.
Still going to town.
Mm-hmm.
I don't remember a year where we had so many peppers.
No, they're fantastic. They like to be crowded. Now we know for sure. We thought so in the past. Then we kind of got away from that. We spread them out a little bit because we had more room, but now we know. Put them close together, they'll be happy. Our squash, especially the spaghetti squash and the zeppelin, the delicata zeppelin, did excellently.
Patty pans were actually short-lived.
Yeah, didn't do too well, and nor did the zucchini.
Well, so. I don't think we had enough zucchini. I don't think we had it spaced enough, and it really got so dense.
Yep.
I think that was part of the problem.
Well, we may end up, if it stays nice, we may end up with some more zucchini before the...
Well, I've got to tell you, that delicata that you served last night, the minute I took my first bite, I knew I was tasting something.
Right.
I had to ask.
Well, delicata, as I'm learning more about it, is more of a winter squash. So when we picked it, we tried eating it immediately, which is fine. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it, and it has a nice flavor. But if you let it sit and cure for a couple of weeks, it gets sweeter and sweeter.
There's a butterfly that's flittering around in your zinnias.
I see, looking at something.
Yep, getting its last little drink before it makes its big journey.
Again, these are the
giant... These got tall. I mean, these are almost
California.
As tall as you.
Well, these are the giant California.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
So they do get big. They're just... I just can't say enough about zinnias. They're wonderful.
Yeah.
Except for that one experience I had the other day.
Oh.
We'll be back. Here he comes.
The one with the hawk?
Yes. I was standing. I'll reenact this. I was standing here, and I had just gathered some squash, and I was picking it up, and I heard something fluttering over in the zinnias. And out of the corner of my eye, I could see a sparrow coming out between here in this trellis. All of a sudden, right in front of my eyes, a hawk flew down, grabbed the squirrel as it was coming out.
Squirrel?
A squirrel. Grabbed the...
Sparrow?
Thank you. The sparrow. See how it still befuddles me. It happened so quickly.
It was a traumatic event.
Grabbed the sparrow and flew off with it in its talons.
It could have been you.
It could have been me, or it could have been Fuzzy. It was amazing. True life nature. This berry jungle down here is an area we're going to have to address again early in the spring. These blackberries have taken over. They were prolific. We had people coming in just eating them because there were just so many of them. We didn't actually do anything with them except eat a few of them raw. But
Mosquitoes are really getting vicious.
Well, when there's a wind, it's fine because it kind of blows them away. The minute the wind stops, we're in trouble.
Well, they said that this is one of the worst mosquito seasons we've had in a long, long time.
Yes, it is. We want to do a quick word about iris. This year, not only do we have a lot of mosquitoes, we have a prolific amount of iris borers. They're big, they're pink, they're ugly. They have attacked every iris bed that we have had. I went through this one earlier in the season. This one seems to be the best one so far, but even this one has suffered.
Well, I'm going to have to dig it up again and replant.
Well, what I'm going to do this year, once the first frost is done, I will be cutting them all the way to the ground. I usually don't do that. I let them, you know, collect leaves and snow and stuff, but this year it's got to be all the way down to the ground to keep the actual grub from getting into the leaves and then down into the roots. Another annual that can become a perennial if you let it go to seed are snapdragons. Now, I never suspected that they could do that, but then we had always put a lot of mulch down. Well, the last couple of years we haven't put a whole lot of mulch in this area, and they have started reseeding themselves and coming up alone. And the same goes with nasturtiums. These nasturtiums, and I love these because of the leaves. They're so beautiful. If you leave some of the flowers there, kind of push them in as they get done blooming, they will reseed themselves and come up again.
Well, as Gene Wilder said in the movie Silver Streak, you have to be nasty to nasturtiums.
They do not like to be pampered. They like to be, you plant them and you leave them alone. Once they get established, same goes with snapdragons. This is the prairie...
Grayhead?
The grayhead prairie coneflowers.
Cone
yeah, the coneflowers. Yeah. There is a little crop of
mushrooms.
Some kind of fungus. The ones to the right are the old ones, or it's a different kind that they're from last year, but they popped up.
Well, remember, this is from that huge maple tree that we cut down many, many years ago.
Right, before this?
Yes.
Snake willow. And that's one of the reasons the soil is so good, but it's also a reason why every now and again, and usually at least once a year, we start getting some kind of fungi growing there.
Too bad we don't get the mushroom that's
the morels.
The
The Morels, ooh, that would be
not
great.
Only Morels, but what's the really one. Expensive one in the
right.
restaurants?
The ones that the pigs go after.
Yes. Maybe we need a pig.
Hey, all right.
Could we have a service pig as a pet?
I talked about coleus earlier and how you can take cuttings from it and then have it live through the winter and replant it. This year we found this variety of coleus, and it is just so brilliant that I wanted to be sure that I got some that last, and so I can replant them next year. It's called Wizard Sun Sunset. So I have taken cuttings myself, and I'm giving cuttings to two of my wonderful friends who are gardeners, kind of as insurance. And I said they could take as many cuttings as they want off of their cuttings, and we could have a whole jungle of red coleus everywhere.
Well, more caladium too.
And more caladium.
And
just
of course,
lovely. Chickweed.
Yep.
Well, here's our pathway.
Yeah, we've been preparing for these ciders for months, and we got rid of, well, three large trees which were in the way,
right.
and pathways. So by the time they get here, I think the snow is already going to be on the ground.
Maybe, but I want to show you this.
Elephant here.
This elephant here.
I'm coming around this side. I mean, look at the size of that ear.
These are just amazing to me. They're tropical. They can't survive this climate. But for the little time that they're here in the summer, they're just amazing. Just amazing.
I imagine the bulb that you're going to be digging up in full.
Yep. Well, look at the
size. Yeah.
The size of the stem. Now last year, and even has a baby coming off the side, another one.
Other side too.
Last year we had such a strange fall that when I dug them up, my elephant ears up, and even my calla lilies and
other tender bulbs.
Other tender bulbs. They didn't have enough time to cure. There wasn't that transition between summer and winter. There wasn't the fall time that they were able to get ready for their sleep. And when I cut them and had to put them away for the winter, they all just withered up and I couldn't use any of them. I had to start all over again. But these guys have done so well. And it's just so neat because it's kind of rubbery.
Yeah.
Very cool. And we're so pleased with our
prairie dock.
This is only the second year that we've had it here. Last year it didn't have a flower. This year it had a very tall flower. Now this is normal for prairie dock. This is how tall they get.
I mean, right now I would say that's at least 10 foot.
Yes, now I have seen bees, there's a bee right now, butterflies and hummingbirds taking advantage of this beauty.
That is one heck of a stalk.
It is. And it's not that thick.
No.
Send yourself back there carefully. We just wanted to give a shout out about this stainless steel flexible hose. I think it's called Flex Hose. We bought them, we saw them, decided that they looked like they would be better than the original ones that you used to see on TV. These have been very, very trustworthy. I have stepped on them many a time.
I've driven on them.
They don't tangle, they're light, and the only thing that Rick finds fault with is that because they're smaller than a 3/4 inch hose, they don't really give you a lot of pressure. Like a guy likes a
well,
like
you get enough
time.
Pressure off of these if you use the right little
nozzle.
But
yeah,
I know
guys like power.
Woo-hoo!
They work very well for watering flowers.
As Tim Allen says,
yes. We had a lot of milkweed this year. We even raised two little monarch caterpillars from tiny, tiny. You could barely see it. to full stage and they flew off. But another milkweed that is very beautiful and stays smaller is the butterfly weed. It stays about this tall. It gets orange blossoms that have been blossoming now for months.
Oh, yeah.
And now the seed pods are getting ready. Now these seed pods will have the little fuzzy seeds in there, that not the helicopters, kind of like the little white parachutes, like a dandelion. These will be loaded with those. And what I do is I take them and I sprinkle them around in the yard so that we have a whole crop of them. Sometimes I share them with people, but mostly I just keep them myself because my husband loves them, and so do I. And the butterflies like them, and so do the bees. Another plant that will seed itself and is very pretty is the balsam. Now, I started with a couple of balsams a couple years ago. They come in pink and darker pink and white. If you don't want them to reseed themselves, then you just cut them off. But these are the little seed pods that will sprinkle their seeds everywhere. These I don't find invasive. They're easily pulled out if you don't want them. And they're very nice. But you can see, there's the seeds. You don't need to do anything with them. They'll open themselves. If you want to do something with them, if you want to save them or move them to a different place, then wait until they're dry. Keep your eye on them though, because all of a sudden they'll just pop open and then they'll sprinkle around and seed themselves. We found two senna plants, S-E-N-N-A. This is the popcorn variety. Again, this is the one where if you pick off a leaf, or you didn't need to pick it, you rub it, and it smells just like buttered popcorn. It's amazing. If you had smell-o-vision, you could smell it from here. And now it has probably tripled in size since we got it.
Easily.
And it has beautiful seed pods that Rick has been waiting and waiting for them to get ready. This is the tropical variety of it. And so he wants me to do a cutting to see if I can actually get it to propagate. I don't think we'd have room to keep this whole thing in the house. So probably a propagation of one branch would be enough. We also have another senna that is a perennial that is also creating seeds, and we'll probably just let that one seed itself where it is because it's in an open area where it'll be fine. But this one had beautiful yellow flowers, and I'm being attacked by a bee, a hornet, not a bee. So I'm done for right now. Oh yeah, that's good. Get me in the breeze and it'll blow it away. Very good. Thank you so much for watching. We hope you enjoyed it and you can kind of compare where your garden is.
And thank you for your patience with us as we've been, busy is not even the correct word.
Right. Thank you for waiting for us. That's what you're saying.
Yes.
If you enjoyed the video, please give us a thumbs up. We truly appreciate that. And if you have comments or questions, leave us a message and we'll get back to you. And if you'd like to become part of our garden family, please subscribe. The little button is over here someplace.
Where's the button?
Down here someplace.
Oh, over in the little corner?
Yes.
Okay.
Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.